knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
As we move forward within the genus Homo, ever closer to modern humans, we finally reach some very familiar organisms. Neanderthals have long been considered the quintessential cavemen, due in part to the fact that they were the first hominins discovered. The first Neanderthal was found in 1829, long before the publishing of Darwin's seminal works On the Origin of Species and The Descent of Man. These fossils were found in Engis, Belgium, and not long after, in 1848 and 1856, Neanderthals from Gibraltar and the Neander Valley would join the known fossil record. At the time, these fossils were thought to be antediluvian men, or humans living before the Great Flood of Genesis. It wasn't until 1864, after Darwin published On the Origin of Species, that these fossils were recognized as something distinct, Neanderthals, or Homo neanderthalensis. Even still, Darwin himself barely referenced these hominins in The Descent of Man in 1871. Today, we have the remains of hundreds of individuals and know quite a bit more about who these hominins were and what they were like. Neanderthals have come a long way since their discovery and unfortunate reputation as brutish and stupid cavemen. In the previous tutorial, we discussed how these hominins shared a common ancestor with modern humans that lived in the rough range of 500 to 800,000 years ago. We also discussed how Homo erectus was capable of using many of the same technologies seen by archaic Homo sapiens. Neanderthals essentially matched archaic Homo sapiens in technological prowess. But before we discuss how Neanderthals lived, what makes them different from Homo sapiens? Neanderthals have long been argued to be the robust and potentially cold-adapted version of us. They are shorter and broader than Homo sapiens, weighing an average of 72.1 kilograms. Neanderthals lacked the long limbs of Homo sapiens, keeping in line with Allen and Bergman's expectations of cold-adapted species being large-bodied with shorter limbs. However, generally their post-crania would be very similar to us, albeit less capable of long-distance running. Neanderthals primarily differ from Homo sapiens in their skull. Neanderthal skulls were long and low, characterized by a sloping forehead and the presence of an odd structure on the occipital bone called an occipital bun. They had large brow ridges. They had zygomatics, or cheekbones, that were swept backwards, exaggerating their already evident midfacial prognathism, and a retromolar gap. However, they also had a modern-looking hyoid bone, suggesting that they would have been capable of speech. Neanderthals looked overall more apish than Homo sapiens, but they actually had a larger brain than us, sporting a range of 1200 to 1740 cc's. However, bigger brains do not necessarily mean a smarter hominin. Neanderthals had a heavy emphasis on the occipital lobe, the region of the brain responsible for vision. They would have had incredible hand-eye coordination, but lacked the frontal lobe emphasis seen in humans that perhaps gives us an edge with critical thinking, planning, and other executive functions. Nevertheless, Neanderthals were capable of a lot. Neanderthals used Mousterian tools, the first toolkit associated with archaic Homo sapiens, and they may have used long-range weapons. They used fire, cooked their food, and have been argued to have additionally smoked, cured, and fermented meat. Neanderthals buried their dead, adorning them with flowers and red ochre. They wore clothes to combat the bitter cold of the steppes they often dwelled upon, and may have crossed waters on seafaring vessels. Neanderthals cared for their sick, utilizing splits for broken bones and all sorts of medicinal plants. They have also been argued to have made art and even music. One might ask at this point why modern Homo sapiens remains and Neanderthals have gone the way of the extinct. We will discuss this in more detail a bit later, but it is worth noting here that life was not easy for Neanderthals. They had to eat a lot of fuel for those large brains, and this meant competing with the carnivores of their landscape for game. Hunting was extremely dangerous, and as a result, the majority of Neanderthal remains display healed wounds or lethal trauma. Fascinatingly, males and females sport the same injury patterns. This suggests that these hominins may not have divided labor among the sexes, perhaps due to the small groups they lived in and the necessity of all members participating in hunting. These injuries were so severe, the best modern analog we have is the pathology exhibited by rodeo riders. The closest relative to Neanderthals actually isn't Homo sapiens, but rather the Denisovans. These hominins lack a formal nomenclature at present because they are effectively known from their genomes alone. The fossil material of Denisovans is scant: bone fragments, a portion of a mandible, and a handful of teeth. These remains were found first at Denisova Cave in modern-day Siberia. Due to the frigid temperatures, scientists thought to attempt to extract DNA from the remains, hoping the cold had preserved some of the DNA. It had, and once the DNA was analyzed, it was found to be different from both Neanderthals and Homo sapiens, belonging to a third, previously unknown hominin. Also in Denisova Cave were myriad tools and even some ornaments. It is debated, however, whether some of the more advanced tools belonged to the Denisovans of the cave or the members of Homo sapiens that came later. Some of the remains in Denisova Cave reveal a fascinating secret. The long bone fragment DNA belonged to a first-generation hybrid between a Neanderthal female and a Denisovan male. Dubbed Denny, the remains belonged to a young girl, around 13 years of age, and demonstrate that hybridization between Denisovans and Neanderthals may not have been uncommon. Homo sapiens also interbred with both species, given modern Europeans average 2% Neanderthal DNA, and modern Southeast Asians average 4-6% Denisovans. Both Neanderthals and Denisovans were complicated hominins with complicated lives. However, it may have been small families that doomed them. Neanderthals survived until around 40,000 years ago, and the last remaining populations are highly inbred. This suggests that shrinking numbers and isolated groups forced Neanderthals to mate within their families, perhaps due in part to the rapidly expanding Homo sapiens. Small numbers and a changing climate would have forced Neanderthals and Denisovans alike to the brink of extinction, where eventually they would succumb to oblivion. This leaves only one hominin remaining on the Earth, Homo sapiens.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.